Sunday, but in the meantime, Reverend Bob Bush and his wife, Teresa, over here somewhere. Okay, I did that. I was called for earlier. They're here this morning, and so there's no second string. So usually I'm like the second string and the third string, and Reverend Bob Bush, there are no second string. Brother Kurt had mentioned me. Brother Kurt, what did you tell me? Team camp. Okay.
Sponsor.
So I just think about my grandbaby, and I just like, I don't remember anything. Team camp. If you're interested in helping folks go to team camp, just see Kurt and or Audra, both of them. Is that right, Brother Kurt? Anything, Audra? Okay, our teams are leaving tomorrow, so be praying for your teams. We've got four of them going. Be praying for those that are going also. And is Miss Hannah going? Is that right? She's an adult, but she's a kid to me, but she's an adult. And her and I go the same. So, are there any other announcements I need to make this morning that I can mess up? We're glad you're here this morning. Let's stand and worship our Lord this morning. It's good to be in God's house.
Thank you.
baptism. And Brother J.C., yeah, notice, Brother J.C. is giving a lot of men a bad name because he has surgery and then he's at church. And because the day I have surgery, you probably see me for like 2 months. But if we want to give God praise for surgery and Brother J.C.'s. But let's turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer. And then Reverend Bob Bush is going to come and pray with us. I worship.
Gigantically, super colossally huge the wings of God are.
I looked it up one time in the Hebrew to see what those wings were like. And you know what it said? It said that the wings of the Almighty are like steely, ironclad, overlapping wings that are so closely overlapping each other that nothing can possibly wiggle or worm or squirm its way underneath. And we are under those wings that are steely ironclad on the outside and soft and comfortable with the presence of God. Wow. We have a lot going for us today. And we're going to go to the Lord in prayer right now. And as we do, let's just open up our hearts to Him. Just open up your heart. He's ready. He's waiting to receive your praise, your prayer, your humility, your humble, your
sweetness to him. And we're going to call Kathy up this morning. Come on up, Ted. Will you, Kathy? Where's Kathy? There she is. She was on the other side a moment ago. Hold the switcheroo on you here. She wants to be anointed. Do we have some anointed? She wants to be anointed on behalf of her brother-in-law, who is in serious condition with COVID. And back at this juncture, it's almost like threatening, isn't it, Kathy? So we want to pray for him today. Wendell is his name. Yes, anyone that would like to come up and pray, lay your hands on Kathy. And God is able, exceeding abundantly, to do above all that we can hope to ever ask or think, according to his power that works in us. Amen?
Amen.
So let's pray right now. Dear Lord, we come to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the three-in-one Godhead, the Trinity. Oh, we love you today. And the Father up in heaven, on his throne, and Jesus, who came as the sacrificial lamb to this earth, fulfilled his mission on the cross, rose from the dead, and returned to heaven to be with the Father, is sitting at your right hand, even now as we pray, interceding on our behalf. And you promised the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, that would come and take your place. And indeed, he has. He lives in us. He walks with us. He talks with us. And he tells us that we are his own. And so we give you all the glory and praise and thanks for that this morning. And we love you supremely with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that enables us and challenges us and motivates us to love our neighbor as we love ourselves, because that's what you would do. And so, Lord Jesus, we approach your throne of grace today and ask for mercy to help us in our time of need. And we do so with confidence and assurance that you are listening in to every word that we pray when we pray it within your will. Because you want your will to be done on earth, in us, through us, even as it is right now, being perfectly carried out in heaven. And so, Lord, we ask that your presence settle upon the service, that you settle upon each one of our hearts, that you draw us closer to you than ever before, and that, God, we would all leave this place better people than when we came through the doors, ready to go out and be missionaries in our community and our neighborhoods. And Lord, we want to bring Kathy to you this morning, who is here to be anointed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, on behalf of her brother-in-law, Wendell, who is seriously ill with COVID. God, you are the miracle worker. You are the interceder. You are the one who brings divine, miraculous intervention. And would you reach across the space right now and touch Wendell as we pray for him and anoint his sister-in-law. God, from the top of his head to the sole of his feet, let your loving care, comforting peace, and healing presence settle upon him and draw him closer to you than ever before. Let him feel the same presence right now that we feel in this place. And bless Kathy, Lord, for her burden, for her brother-in-law, and her family. And for all others who may be sick and afflicted or going through difficulties, Lord, we don't know what they are, but you know what they are, who they are. And we pray for them as well, that your healing power will rest upon them and encourage them and challenge them to keep on keeping on in their walk with you. And Lord, bless Ron and his dear wife today, Pastor Ron, thank you for his ministry at Shelbyville First Church of the Nazarene. Thank you, God, for the longevity of ministry you've given him here. Thank you, Lord, for his love for his people. And I pray your richest blessings upon them today with health and strength. And for all of these things, for all of the needs that we come into this place for, with it all, we humbly lay it at your nail-scarred feet and ask for your blessing today. We pray these things now from our hearts in the strong name of Jesus. We reach out, we receive it from your hand gladly, thankfully, joyfully. In Jesus' name we pray. And God's people say, amen. You may be seated. God bless you.
Says that we need to have faith and believe, and our salvation comes from that belief, from faith, plus nothing. What a gift. It's a gift that we have to be reminded of from time to time, because we hear about it all the time, I know, but you know, that's a gift. And we have to receive it. We have to believe. And there are times when maybe we don't feel God's love, but He's there always. And in faith, we just accept it. And then sometimes feeling comes later. You know, I remember years and years ago, because I'm old. When I got saved, and I kept, you know, I was one of those people who kept going back to the altar, going back to the altar. And one day I heard God say, just believe. That's it. It's real simple. It's real simple. Just believe. So I did. Here I am. Where I don't deserve to be.
I keep hearing voices in my mind that say,
I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Ooh, oh, you said I am loved, and I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong, when I think I am weak. You say I am helped, and I am falling short. And when I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me.
You all look like Nazarenes. the same man of reason, not Baptists, not Presbyterians, not Pentecostals, not Catholics, although we're all heading for the same place, right? Striving to get to the same place, but you all look like Nazarenes and you look like Nazarene Christians. You have smiling faces, your countenances shine with the beauty of Jesus, and that encourages my heart. And it makes me glad to be standing in this place right now, and I consider it the highest honor and privilege to be in this pulpit today. It is a real honor to be here. Thank you for letting me come and worship with you today. And my wife, Risa, this coming August, celebrate 56. And I can't believe the year. I can't believe the years have gone by so fast. You who are maybe in that same bracket, you're with me. You look back and you wonder, where have the years gone? Because you know what I feel like up here? A gawky kid. Awkward. Half the time, maybe not even knowing what I'm going to do next, but the years have come and gone, and here we are. We are here. And believe it or not, you who are in your 20s and 30s, one of these days, God willing, you're going to be where we are. So enjoy it now, but enjoy it for Jesus. So, Ted, enjoy it for Jesus. You may not remember an awful lot of what I say today, and that's fine, because I don't really want you to remember anything but what the Holy Spirit has impressed it upon your heart. That's the critical, crucial issue. But I do want you to remember the scripture that we share together today. And I have chosen this morning, I feel very, very strongly led by the Spirit and have now for a couple of weeks at least, to share multiple sections of scripture with you, not in an exegetical kind of a way, but in a way that is practical, grassroots, down to earth, of right where you and I live and move and have our being. That's what the Christian life is all about, isn't it? Amen. Applying the Word of God to where we live, so that we can be more like Jesus. That's the whole purpose of being a Christian. A Christ follower is being like Jesus. And there are some Bible passages that have impacted and revolutionized my life, literally, over the last 15 years or so. Probably longer than that even. But it just seems like in these recent years, they have impacted and revolutionized my thinking more than ever. And if you have a pencil and a piece of paper, you can jot down some of these references, okay? And if you don't want to, that's fine. Some people are writers and some people are not. Some people are listeners. That's good. But I hope that these Bible verses will impact and revolutionize your life as well. Now, here's one thing I would like for us to do. If you have your Bible, would you take it and hold it in your hands up like this? All right, we have a lot of Bibles. Wow, that's fantastic. This is our textbook. This is our guidebook for life. One of the best acronyms that I've ever heard for Bible, B-I-B-L-E, is this. Basic instructions before leaving Earth. Isn't that good? Now, I didn't come up with that. I'd love to lay claim to it, but I can't. Basic instructions before leaving Earth. God has given us basic instructions for how we are to live before we leave this Earth. Okay. Now, those Bibles that you held up a moment ago, would you open them like this? Just take your Bible and open it up. And look down at the printed page. And what you see there on the printed pages of your Bible is but the surface of the waters. You're looking out over a broad ocean that underneath the surface of the waters is literally teeming with life. I Googled the other day to see how many species of life are estimated in the oceans of this earth. And it said approximately over 1 million different species of life exist in the ocean. Think of that. But since God's word is everlasting, eternal, forever, just think of the life that is teeming beneath, in between the lines of what you read on the printed page. That's just the beginning of what God has for you and me. And when you delve into the Greek and the Hebrew, and I don't consider myself to be a scholar, although I had Greek when I was in seminary years ago. But nowadays, the internet has made it so easy for us to read beyond just the printed words on the page. All we have to do is just go to a simple phrase or word or verse of scripture and ask the question, Google the question, what does sola mean in John 3:16? And it will pull up a multitude of internet connections there, websites that will explain to us the deeper, much more intense meaning of what God is saying when he says he so loved us, the world. So anybody can be a Greek scholar now or a Hebrew scholar. Okay, with that in mind, let me further say that to me, the Word of God is like, it's like a crystal prism, P-R-I-S-M. How many of you know what a prism is? It's like a beautiful crystal ball that has hundreds of different little slants etched in the glass. And if you hold that prism up to the light, what do you see? You see all kinds of tints and shades and hues and tones and pastels and bulbs and slants and angles. You just see all kinds. A whole new world opens up. That's what the Bible is to me. It's like a beautiful crystal prism. It is also to me like an iceberg. How many of you know how much of the iceberg that is sticking up above the surface of the waters? How many of you know how much of the iceberg is beneath the surface of the waters? Well, I didn't know until I looked it up. 90% of the iceberg is under the water. When you see it sticking up, it's only 10% of the overall iceberg. Can you imagine the size of the gigantic iceberg that the Titanic struck? 90% beneath the surface. Well, if the Word of God is eternal and everlasting and forever, then just think of the percentage of God's word that's in between the lines, underneath the surface of the waters. And not only that, when we get out there into heaven one of these days, God's word is going to continue to live out there. It's going to continue to stretch our minds and blow our minds beyond belief. We're not just going to be little angels sitting around on clouds out there strumming a little harp like a cherub. Oh no. We're going to be exploring and looking and adventuring and pioneering and serendipitying. And I mean, it's just the surprise will be endless for all of eternity. And in and through it all, God's word is going to be our foundation. And God will continue to speak to us out there in Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even beyond what he does here while we're here on this earth. Wow. Well, let me just tell you one more thing about what the Bible means to me. The Bible, to me, is like going from one opposite extreme to the other here, where I said it was an iceberg, now it's like a fire. Where the author of the words has come down from heaven and inspired the pens and the quills of more than 40 different authors over a period of 1,500 years to write the infallible word of God. And it's like the fire of God has fallen down upon these people who have been inspired to write the scriptures, and as we read the scriptures, it's like the fire and the flames of the scripture words themselves and their meanings are just reaching right back up toward the very fire that fell when they were inspired to be written. It's like a white, hot, blue fire, the word of God. Wow. Well, let me just share with you now and be ready to jot down these references, okay? I think they'll be extremely meaningful for you. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21 says something like this. You will hear a voice behind you and within you saying, this is the way, walk you in it. When you turn to the right hand, and when you turn to the left. In other words, as we are going along through our lives, our daily lives, the Holy Spirit never sleeps. He is constantly vigilant for us, even when we are not vigilant for ourselves, as we should be. And so when we're about to make a decision, or about to make a wrong turn, or about to go to the right or to the left, the Holy Spirit, who never wants us to make a mistake, never wants us to sin, never wants us to err, that still, small, quiet, soft, sweet, tender, compelling, persuasive, comforting, convicting voice of the Holy Spirit will speak within our hearts, and he will say, wait a minute, whoa, watch out, danger ahead, detour ahead, be careful, don't go this way. Go this way. Now that's the Holy Spirit speaking to us, because he has only our best interests at heart and our eternal welfare. He doesn't want us to go astray or to err. He doesn't want us to stop keeping our eyes off of Jesus, who is our lighthouse, because he knows that if we don't stay focused on Jesus, we can easily drift in either too close to the shoreline where the rocks and the shoals are and end up in shipwreck, or we can drift too far out to sea where we lose sight of our lighthouse. My wife and I just 2.5 years ago now, almost three, this coming September and October, took the trip of a lifetime and went up the eastern seaboard, followed the coastline up the eastern seaboard, clear into Maine, and then coming back, went down through the interior of states, and we covered every single New England state that there is. 14. And we were impressed to visit the Portland Head Lighthouse in Cape Elizabeth, Maine. And what an experience. It's one that you see more often than any other lighthouse. And if you go to Red Lobster, you'll see it in a big, huge frame on the wall of the Red Lobster restaurant. And just a beautiful board. And I was so inspired by going to that place, just so awestruck to think of what all it symbolizes and the shipwrecks it has prevented and all of this, that I came home inspired to make my hobby is woodwork. And I came home inspired the nearly 2,000 miles with my wheels just turning 90 miles an hour in my mind on what I could do to make a grandfather lighthouse clock. And I finished it about 6 months ago. It stands 7.5 feet tall. It has two clocks underneath the light at the top. The light on this side is central time, which is our time. The clock on this side is eastern time, which is representative of the Portland Head Lighthouse time zone. And that's my claim to fame as far as woodworking goes. It is one of a kind in the entire world, I'll grant you that. I lay claim to it. Others may not want to even touch it with a 10-foot pole, but it means something to me. The lighthouse, our lighthouse, is Jesus. Gotta stay focused on it, don't we? So Isaiah 30:21, keep that in your mind. Put that on the fly leaf of your noggin and don't forget it. Isaiah 30:21. Hear a voice within you. That voice, that word, is the voice and the word of the Holy Spirit saying, this is the way, walk you in it when you turn to the right hand or when you turn to the left. Another scripture verse that has impacted me is Galatians chapter 2, verses 22 and 23. This one impacts me every single day that I live. It crosses my mind every day. But the fruit of the Spirit is, and if you know these in the King James, we're listening, say them with me. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Let's back up. Fruit of the Spirit is love, meaning the agape love of God. Not selfless, selfish, self-centered love, but agape love. The kind of love that gives of itself and gives and gives and gives, even if it doesn't receive anything back in return. You know, our human love today, our definition of love in the human natural sense is, well, I'll love you if you'll give me something back in return. That's not the way God does. Then joy. Not joy dependent upon outward circumstances. Because sometimes outward circumstances are depressing and discouraging and oppressive. But joy that just bubbles up like an artesian well on the inside of our hearts, regardless of what our outer circumstances are. The joy of the Lord is my strength, the Bible says. Then peace. Do you know that at the exact moment that the United States was sitting down at the peace treaty tables with Japan to sign the peace treaty together, Japan was sending its kamikaze pilots to bomb Pearl Harbor? At the very moment we were sitting down with our ambassadors to sign peace treaties. That tells me that we can't trust in man's definition of peace. Only God's definition of peace, which means true tranquility and serenity and calmness. Whoa. Then Paul the Apostle, in his listing of the fruit, goes on to say, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, which means patience. My wife will tell you, don't question her too closely, that patience is one of the most difficult virtues that I've had to work on. We've been married a long time now, and I credit her longevity of patience with me over the years. Because when we first got married, I remember that I was sort of the mentality, the macho male mentality, that, well, I'm right. And anyone who doesn't agree with me is wrong. You men don't think that way, I hope. And it occurred to me one day over time that my wife has just as good of ideas as I have ever had. And indeed, two heads are better than one. And indeed, when I took her on board with me to be co-captain, so to speak, of our relationship, well, there was a whale of a lot more peace in our relationship. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. Gentleness means kindness. Compassion. Sympathy, empathy. Do you think that our world would be in a better shape today if there were a lot more kindness? If nations were kinder with nations, if Republicans were kinder with Democrats, if churches were kinder with churches that are not of the same label that they are, if husbands and wives were a lot kinder with each other, if parents were kinder with their children, I mean, the list goes on and on and on. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness means wholesomeness, rightness, righteousness, goodness, and faith. Faith simply means not only what we believe, which has got to be right, our faith belief system has got to be the right faith belief system. If our faith is not in Jesus Christ, then our faith is the wrong faith belief system. If our faith does not include Jesus Christ in as the second person of the Godhead, then ladies and gentlemen, we are serving the wrong God. G with a small g and not a capital G. For if Jesus is indeed the way, the truth, and the life, then I assure you that all roads, like everybody is saying today, all roads do not lead to heaven. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No man or woman or boy or girl comes to the Father except by, in, and through me, Jesus said. And I'm telling you this morning, if our faith is not in Him, and it also faith means faithfulness, how loyal we are to Jesus, how faithful we are to our wives and our husbands, how devoted we are to them, that's all included in faith. Then there is the word love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness. Normally when we think of meekness, we think of someone who is really timid, shy, almost kind of nervous. Jesus, the scripture tells us, was meek. And I assert to you today that it was not a timid, weak nerve that died on the cross. It was a man's man. It took guts for him to die on that cross and to go through with the agonizing ordeal of pain and suffering and agony. So meekness means, well, what do you think it means? It means humility. It means humbleness. He humbled himself even to the death of the cross. It means turning the other cheek, going the extra mile, giving the inner coat as well as the outer coat. That's meekness. I read the story one time of St. Francis of Assisi. I read his biography, and I was amazed at how meek and humble and full of humility St. Francis was. He left an affluent family. His father was a seller of rich cloth and fabric, the kind of cloth and fabric that would have been sold to kings and people in high places. So his father was very affluent, and St. Francis, feeling the call of God upon his life, renounced that and felt that God wanted him to go into the ministry. And he assumed such a spirit of meekness that, well, he had a band of followers whom they called disciples back in those days, and we're going back 1,000+ years ago now. For St. Francis, whose name still lives on today in the annals of Christendom, Catholic or not. And the story is told one time how Francis and his band of disciples were going through the countryside. He was an itinerant kind of preacher going from place to place to place. And they went, they were traveling through the countryside, across the fields, the meadows, and the rivers, and all of that. And they came to an old barn out in the middle of the field. And we're going to bed down for the night. And as the story goes, an old drunken man came along upon them, and in his drunken stupor, obstinately and selfishly insisted that they leave the barn, that that was his place to rest for the night. And he wanted it all to himself. Well, I know what you and I would have done. We would have stood up and we would have said, first come, first serve. I was here first. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. Whatever that means. And you know what Francis said? He said, men, let's get our belongings together. And we're going to quietly leave. And they left. That is a spirit of meekness, humility, humbleness. And that is the way Jesus was.
And then finally, there is the last of the ninefold fruit of the Spirit called temperance, or self-control, or self-discipline. You know, ladies and gentlemen, this morning, if people had this aspect of the fruit of the Spirit in their hearts and lives, if they were bearing the fruit of temperance, of self-control, self-discipline, there would be no addictions. There would be no bad habits. There would be no giving in to the indulging of sin and temptation. And incidentally, do you realize today that temptation is nothing more, nothing less than a simple suggestion on the part of Satan? And temptation has no power at all within it except that which we give. Satan can't make us sin, nor can God make us be a Christian. It's our choice, our volitional choice, free will choice. And so, if we would say no to sin in the very beginning stages, no to temptation at the outset, well, I think Barney Fife, the Gospel of Barney Fife, is really good here. Nip it in the bud. Immediately nip it. Then we don't have to worry for it to gain any momentum and any strength in our lives in any way, shape, or form. So the fruit of the Spirit has impacted my life, and I want to bear it on an everyday basis. And before I leave this particular point, do you know that the fruit of the Spirit is the very nature, the very personality, the very character of Jesus Christ himself? If you want to know how Jesus was and is, it's the fruit of the Spirit. You want to be more like Jesus? Start showing the fruit of the Spirit. Then, here's another passage that I'd like for you to jot down. It's impacting. It's Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. And this is what it says. That death and life are both in the power of the tongue. And those who love it, either death or life, will eat of its fruits thereof. Stop and think about that. If I am a Murphy's Law, negative, pessimistic kind of talker and thinker, I am speaking the negativity of death into my own very life. But if I am an optimistic thinker, combined with the truth and the life of God's Word, I am speaking life into my life. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. Even a little child can understand that. Incidentally, do you know the difference between an optimist and a pessimist? The optimist gets up in the morning, swings his legs over the bed, stands up, stretches, yawns, walks over to the window, throws open the blinds, looks out at the sunshine, and says, "Good morning, God." That's an optimist. You know what a pessimist is? He sits up in bed, rubs the sleep out of his eyes, stands up, crouches his way over to the window, peeks out through the blinds, and says, "Good God, it's morning."
What is the difference
between an optimist and a pessimist? Death and life are in the power of your tongue. Stop with your negative thinking and speak life out of your tongue. Stop saying, "Well, the devil is so heavy on me today, I don't know how I can make it." Start saying, "If God is for me, who can be against me?"
Amen.
What a difference.
Amen.
We speak into our lives that which comes out of it. In fact, James the Apostle says, "How is it possible for both bitter and sweet waters to come out of the same spring?" If we truly love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, why would we want to speak anything out of our mouths that the devil would want us to speak? Why wouldn't we want to speak everything that the Holy Spirit wants us to speak? Now, here's another reference. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. Philippians 4:13. All of you can quote this with me, I am sure. And it goes simply like this: "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." There's a paraphrase, I don't know where it came from, but I read it several years ago that absolutely blew me away. And this is it: "I can do all things through Christ who infuses His strength into me." Now that changes the nature of everything there. If the strength of Jesus Christ is being infused right into my system, I can do anything because He can do anything. Wow. And let me ask you this: is the strength of Jesus Christ perfect? Is it perfect? Not a trick question. Is the strength of Jesus Christ perfect?
Yes.
Absolutely. So if His perfect strength is flowing through me, how can I fail? If it's His strength, then as a trailer to that passage, write down Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Here we find the Apostle Paul saying, "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, and yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me." I ask you this, no trick question: is the faith of Jesus Christ perfect? Well, if I'm living by the perfect faith of Jesus Christ, how can I fail? How can I doubt? How can I fall? And then finally, Genesis chapter 1, verse 3. Part of the creation story here, where God says four incredible words. And I'm capitalizing all four of these words. God said, verse 3, chapter 1, Genesis, "Let there be light." You know what God is saying to you this morning? In the chaos of your daily life, in your troubled marriage, in your parent-child relationships, in your relationships with your friends. You know what God will say? Let there be light. And what is God's light? It is His light of the world. Jesus Himself. You see, everything points back to Jesus. Everything. If Jesus is not at the center of your world or your universe, you're out of kilter with the Creator of your universe. I read years ago, I think it was in a either Time magazine or a Newsweek magazine. It was some seminary professor somewhere here in the United States that made the incredible statement in his article that there is just too much attention placed on Jesus Christ in our world. How misguided can you get, Mr. Professor? Let there be light in your life. Everything revolves around Jesus. Everything. The Father's plan of redemption revolves around Jesus Christ. If it weren't for Jesus, you and I would be hellbound today and not even realizing that we were going there and wake up there some tragic day. Oblivious, totally oblivious. Let there be light. Now, let me close with this. You've been very kind and patient. My wife said, be very careful about your time. Let me close with this. Have you ever heard of what an axiom is? An axiom, A-X-I-O-M, an axiom. An axiom is a peak of unchanging eternal truth. On every single one of your houses, there is a high point to your roof. And that is what is called the apex of your house, or the axiom of your house. It's the highest peak. And axiom means, well, let me put it this way. There are truths, and all truth is truth, of course, but then there are other truths that just seem to rise up head and shoulders above the normal truth. For example, the truth is that I love chocolate. I'm a chocoholic. My mother was a chocoholic, so I come by it honestly. My mother loved chocolate so much that she had a little pillow on her sofa that had embroidered on the pillow. I stopped eating chocolate, but I'm no quitter. And the last time we had my mom over to our house, maybe a year, year and a half before she passed away, 4 years ago, she went through our cupboard and went through our canisters and through our nooks and crannies and found every single solitary piece of chocolate that we had. When she left, 3 days later, our house was empty with chocolate. Isn't that right, honey? It's a truth that I love chocolate. But that truth does not stack up against the truth of God's Word. For example, would you say that the Ten Commandments of Almighty God are true? Absolutely. They are axioms chiseled in the granite of eternity. They cannot be changed. People change. But God's truth never changes. We're living in a day today when our nation, politically speaking, in order to be politically correct, is saying that truth is in the eye of the beholder. How How foolish can we be? If that statement is true, that means that there are 8 billion definitions of truth, because that's how many people are living on the planet now. If that statement is true, that means there are 330 million definitions of truth in the United States alone. No, truth is not in the eye of the beholder. Truth is in here.
Amen.
This is truth. And we either line ourselves up with this truth, or we'll pay the piper. Kind of like the Ram Oil commercial that we used to see on TV when he's saying that we need to get a new oil filter to keep our engine running smoothly in our car. And at the close of the commercial, he says, you can pay me now $6.95 for a new oil filter, or you can pay me later when you're buying a $3,000 engine. Truth is truth. Okay. I'm going to give you quickly 3 axioms that have impacted my life. And here they are. Here's number 1. It sounds rather scholarly on the surface, but it's easy to understand. God is under no obligation to reveal the next step of his plan to you until first you have enacted upon the previous installment of his revelation to you. That's an eternal truth. In simple, down-to-earth, grassroots language, it simply means steps A, B, C first before God gives us steps C, D, and E. Take care of first things first. When the Holy Spirit speaks to us, take care of that on the spot. And then when we're faithful to do that, then he'll show us additional light. We follow the light of the Holy Spirit in our daily lives, and he shines light on our pathway where we're walking now. He doesn't want us to run ahead of him or to lag behind him. He wants us to stay in rhythmic step with him, day by day by day. Secondly, if you keep on doing what you're doing, you're going to keep on getting. That's an eternal truth. Which simply means that if you're having problems now, difficulties now, and you're just limping along, well, if you keep on doing what you're doing, you're going to keep on limping along in your problem. Change, necessary change, has got to take place. And the walk with God is a progressive walk. You may pause once in a while to help us to catch our breath, but by and large, our walk with God is a forward march kind of walk. We are marching to heaven. We are progressing to heaven. There is forward progress going on there. So if we are content to just keep on doing what we're doing, then wow, we're just going to keep on getting what we're doing. And then finally, and this one I heard, my wife and I had a Gaither Family Fest in Gatlinburg, Tennessee about 7 years ago. The special speaker on the Sunday morning there, that Memorial Day Sunday, was Andy Andrews. He's one of the well sought after motivational speakers in our nation today. And God has brought him a long way from homelessness when he was a young man to being one of the most sought after motivational speakers. He simply said this, and when he said it, it absolutely was like a bucket of cold water thrown in my face. Here it is. Ready? Are you ready? Whatever you focus upon increases. Whatever you focus upon, what will it be? get bigger and bigger. If you focus on career, bigger and bigger and bigger. If you focus on temptation, bigger and bigger and bigger. If you focus on the fact that you're falling in love with someone, bigger and bigger and bigger. If you focus on Jesus, he gets bigger and bigger and bigger. It doesn't matter what it is. That was what John the Baptist was saying in the third chapter of John's Gospel, verse 30. When some of his disciples came to him and said, John, this man Jesus has come on the scene now. Should we, and many people are beginning to follow him, should we continue to follow you, John, or should we start following this Jesus? And John's classic answer, John chapter 3, verse 30, with these words, he must increase, but I must decrease. Jesus has got to get bigger and bigger and bigger in my life and in your life. Especially so, dear friends, now that we are getting closer and closer and closer to his return. Signs of the times. We're not just talking about the United States, we're talking globally now, the signs of the times. And even if Jesus doesn't return physically in our lifetimes, one thing is for dead sure, he's going to return for each one of us individually. So we want to be ready. We want to be prepared. That little song, that little chorus has been going through my mind all morning, long before when I first woke up, long before we left Murfreesboro to come over here to Shelby. Did I say that right? Shelby Lord. Or Shelbyville. Shelby. I'm getting there. That little beautiful chorus that the Nazarenes have sung for years and years, and I hope have meant it with all our hearts. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yield to this still. Let's stand together as we sing that in closing. And if anyone should feel the need to pray, even though this is not what I would call an official altar call, would sure be for anyone to be left out. They feel they need to come forward and make something right with the Lord. Otherwise, we can do it standing right in our seats, and we can meet it with all of our hearts. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way.
chapter of Jeremiah that the Lord spoke to Jeremiah the prophet one day and said, Jeremiah, I want you to go down to the potter's shop and I want you to watch while the potter makes something on his wheel. So Jeremiah obeyed, went down to the potter's shop, stood quietly and watched the potter as he deftly, expertly, exquisitely molded and shaped a vessel on that spinning wheel out of clay. And the Lord spoke to Jeremiah after he viewed that scene, and he said, Jeremiah, this is what I want to do with my people Israel. I want to mold and shape them into my likeness, my image. Take that message back to my people. That's what God wants to do with us each day of our lives. Mold us, shape us, fashion us into his image and likeness. That's what being a Christian is all about. Being Christ-like. Amen. So as we leave this place today, we go out into our neighborhoods, in our community, it becomes our mission field. You're missionaries when you leave this church today. Somebody's watching your life. Somebody's going to be watching your life. You're not going to know who they are, but they're going to be watching intently your life. Does this person have what they profess? Do they possess what they profess? Do they walk the way they talk? That's what it all comes down to. And in pointing the one finger out to you, three fingers to point back to me. We're all in this thing together. I mean, leave you with this thought about the potter wanting to shape and mold us into his image. Remember, the Creator is our manufacturer. We are his products. The manufacturer knows best how the product is to function and work. When we buy a toaster or a TV set or an automobile, what comes with those things? Instructions, right? Manuals. Here's our manual. Basic instructions before leaving earth. God bless you. Lord, bless your people today. Encourage them as they go from this place today to live closer than ever to you. Help us all to make it to heaven. And that's our goal. And in the process, to please you on the journey and to enjoy fellowship with you. Again, bless Pastor Ron and his family. Bless them dearly. Bless the continued ministry of his outpoured love upon his people here, upon your people, in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you.